Thank you, Samantha. My God, I'm busy here. A lot of gigs. Welcome to the Brompton Center for the 92nd Street Y. This is a truly historic night. Many of you may have already realized that tonight is auspiciously also the anniversary of Kristallnacht. Ooh, that's right. Perhaps it is appropriate that we would gather today on this anniversary for a reunion and a reminder that throughout the Cold War, 3 million Jews were stuck on the wrong side of the Iron Curtain. They were prevented from practicing their Judaism. They were deprived of a spiritual and cultural existence. The synagogues had been closed. They were prevented from reading Hebrew. And worst of all, they were denied the right as citizens of any country to leave, to emigrate to wherever they wish to go, certainly Israel or the United States. The Soviets refused these rights to Jewish Russians, and so 1,000 of them opposed Soviet oppression by signing up and seeking exit visas to leave. Of course, the Soviet Union refused, and they then became known as refuseniks. The most famous refusenik in the world is joining us tonight. We all know him for many reasons. We're going to meet him in this very profound and powerful night. Natan Sharansky is familiar to you now as not only the head of the Jewish Agency, but he's a former deputy prime minister of Israel, a longtime member of the Israeli Knesset. But there was a time when this man was the face of the movement, and please welcome and join me in welcoming Natan Sharansky. This is Heroes Night, actually, at the 92nd Street Y. Yes, Natan, you are a hero. As we know, the Soviet Jews finally were able to leave. It took a great deal of heroic effort by many people. There were political dissidents, certainly in the Soviet Union, but there were also very keen and cagey political American operators in the United States, not in the White House per se, but certainly in the United States Senate. We'll be talking about one of them today, Senator Scoop Jackson. Many may not remember. Yes. The United States Senate put pressure on the Soviet Union with the Jackson-Vanik Amendment, which essentially tied arms control and trade to a much more favorable immigration policy for Soviet Jews. The Soviet Union wanted wheat. We had it. And the cost of doing business was to provide more exit visas. Senator Scoop Jackson's chief lieutenant, a man who we now know and remember as having been a political advisor to President George W. Bush and President Reagan, but back in this time, Richard Perle was the chief political chief legislative assistant for Scoop Jackson, and through his tireless efforts, rallied support on Capitol Hill, by far the most important man in Capitol Hill, for with great energy and passion, a true righteous man, the Jackson-Vanik Amendment was completely, his participation was pivotal. And so please welcome Richard Perle. Now, American Jewry during this period finally found its voice. It developed its own political muscle. It didn't know it even had it. And so we all of a sudden had agitators and protesters and demonstrators and persons of conscience, and then there were people who simply provided a moral voice. And this gentleman to my right, who is this gentleman to my right? How did you get here? Do you have any connection to the 92nd Street Y? Elie Wiesel, shortly after having written Night, which is the book everyone remembers him for, but he's written 40 books, the other 39 are worth a look too. I've read them, I know, it's not just a pitch. In 1965, he traveled to Moscow and he came back inspired to write a book. The book was The Jews of Silence. It's a profoundly important book. We're going to talk to Eli tonight about what he remembers in 1965. What did he see? Why did he go? But he brought back a monument, a real testament to Soviet Jewry, and a real call to action. So let us welcome Noblest Eli Wiesel. Now, thank you, excuse me. We have a really good excuse for a reunion. It's not just Kristallnacht. Last year, this book was published by Gal Beckerman, who's joining us today. When They Come for Us, We'll Be Gone, The Epic Struggle to Save Sober Jewry. It's a great read. It reads like an espionage thriller. I actually reviewed it for the LA Times. I liked it. And I said, what the hell, let's have a show. And so I invited Gal and brought some heroes on stage with him. Gal is presently the opinion editor for The Forward. Let's welcome Gal Beckerman. Well, Gal, let's start with you since you're the youngest.
Sure.
You're like
the non-hero on stage.
Yes, you're not a hero, but you are like a putschki on stage. You know, you're the young one. Why this story? What was compelling about the story? Why is it such a fascinating, compelling story that drove you to write such a book that frankly hadn't been written before, correct?
Right. Well, first of all, before I answer the question, I want to say thank you to all of you for being here. You're all writers of books, so you understand that the process of writing a book is often this walk down a very long, dark tunnel. And it was an evening like this that I fantasized about, you know, that I really imagined could be at the end of that. So, and thank you, Thane, for persevering and making this happen. It's really such an honor. Well, the significance of the Soviet Jewry movement, I think, is that there's two levels to it. At one level, this is, I think, after the Holocaust and the birth of Israel, one of the most important Jewish stories of the 20th century, because it's an incredible redemption story. For those people who survived the Holocaust and went to Israel, they had the Great Zionist Project to kind of channel their energy. But for American Jews and Soviet Jews, the two largest Jewish groups in the diaspora, I think the war left them with deep wounds, with deep scars. American Jews had this very kind of psychological, you know, feeling that they could have done more. By the 60s, it was a really strong sense that maybe there was a passivity to the community, that the Jewish part of their American Jewish identity had begun to kind of feel hollow. I think this movement kind of gave them that back. And it also, you know, it helped them to build their political muscle. It helped them to overcome that scar. Soviet Jews were left with a very physical scar, a scar that ran along the length of the Iron Curtain. They were cut off from the rest of the Jewish world. By the 1960s, it was three generations since the Bolshevik Revolution, since there had been any outlet for Jewish culture, let alone religion. So the redemption story there is a physical redemption story. And that, so as at a Jewish level, it fascinated me. And then there's a kind of universal, global, almost diplomatic level, which I'd been fascinated by the question of how human rights became a part of our foreign policy. And you have to look to this movement to understand that, to understand how the ideals, American ideal of human rights became more than just rhetoric, but became, especially in the Jackson-Vanik Amendment, linked to our foreign policy, in a piece of legislation that for the first time in history pointed to the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and said, this is our compass. I think for both those reasons, I think this is an extremely important movement.
The 92nd Street Y, as you know, is on the cutting edge of all technology. So we're going to show you some photos. John, our friend John Kelly, is going to be helping us out here tonight. John, let's take a look at the first one. Hi. Natan Sharansky, you were on my parents' coffee table for years. We never got rid of that. That was the July 1978 cover of Time magazine. Only a few short months before that, you had been imprisoned. You had been sentenced to prison for 13 years. Your brother purportedly shouted out in the courtroom that the world is with you. Did you think that the world was with you? Did you? By the way, first of all, did you know that you eventually were? Did you know that you were on the cover of Time magazine?
No, I didn't know that.
They didn't deliver to you.
And I don't think that that was the most important thing for me to know. I knew very little, but I felt a lot, and I felt that we are in the middle of historical struggle, that all the people of Israel and all the Jews are with me. I knew, well, you said it was a few months after I was arrested. It was 16 months after I was arrested. Mm. And all these 16 months, KGB was, they were not putting a light in my eyes as here, but all they were doing, but all the rest they were doing to convince me that.
We should have been more sensitive about that.
Yeah. All the rest they were really doing to convince me that I am abandoned, that the Jews of the world are afraid to mention my name, because the moment they understand that it's all about espionage, that's the end. And I knew that it's all nonsense. I knew it's lies. I because of my years of struggle, I knew how strongly the Jews of the world are with us. And as a result, I felt that every day that I'm saying no to KGB, it's another day of our victory. So that what was important for me. That's why when my brother shouted what he shouted, it was like approval of what I'm doing. I didn't know, but I didn't know all, practically anything of what was happening.
Outside.
Outside, yeah.
How did you think it was going to end up? You sat in prison for 9 years. What did you think was going to happen? Did you think you'd be released before 13 years?
Look, I saw many times how I'll be released, but it's all always was in my dreams, and always in the end you wake up and you go back to your punishing cell or to your interrogation. So on a very early stage, I understood that if my aim will be to be released, I'll be broken, and that will be the end of the struggle. So very early you have to understand that your aim should not be to be released. Your aim, your dream is to be released, but your aim should be to remain free person in prison. And as long as they cannot break you, that is already victory for you and for your people. Of course, I hoped that one day I'll be released, and I dreamt about it.
Let's, John, let's take a look at another photo. You know, if any of you have comments about any of the people we're looking at, this is, of course, Andrei Sakharov and Elena Bronner, who Sakharov, as you know, was the father of the Soviet hydrogen bomb. He himself, like Elie Wiesel, had won a Nobel Peace Prize and was the world's most famous dissident, surely before Natan. John, let's take another photo. I love this picture. This is Natan Sharansky, of course, in the middle. And here are, it's a group portrait of some refuseniks. Yeah.
Not and just some.
Some. The review, the main.
This is the A-team over here.
This is the A-team, right. And you're smiling. Do you remember this day?
No. but I remember that we were smiling. I remember that this, to discover that you can be a free person even in the Soviet Union, and that you can be very deeply connected to the historic struggle of your people, was a very good feeling, and that's why we all smiled.
Great. John, let's look again. One more. Oh, I love this. Oh, yeah. This is Refusnik's celebration of Roshki Forest. You wouldn't know. It looked like a bunch of New York hippies. And let's take a look at another photo. This is Refusnik's protesting in Leningrad.
And this is at the very end.
Yeah, I mean, this is significant because, in fact, they're not actually getting arrested here.
Right, exactly. Right.
This is toward the end, and they're actually going to continue to be protesting and will not. I don't know if that's the KGB, but they'll get to stay there. John, let's take a look at another picture. Let's move on to the next frames. Yeah, yeah, not that one. Here we go. So here, and we'll get Richard Pearl to comment in a moment. Here you see a picture of Scoop Jackson, of course, who we all applauded a moment ago, the patron saint of Soviet Jewry. And he's flanked, let me see, Gal, you can help me. This is Dimshitz is on the right.
On the
Kuznetsov is...
Kuznetsov is wearing the glasses, the horn-rim glasses.
Right. And Dimshitz is on the left.
Right.
And these are, what, two of the 16?
Yeah, these are the two leaders, really, of an extraordinary episode in this book. You ask why I wanted to write this book. It was because of, I mean, partly at least because of incredibly dramatic stories like the Leningrad hijacking that these guys led.
These 16 people attempted to hijack a plane in Leningrad.
They attempted in 1970 to hijack a plane. The KGB was onto them from the beginning. They arrested them on the tarmac. And put on a big show trial. The Soviets thought this was their opportunity to unmask Zionism as just hooliganism, as the Soviets like to call it. And they sentenced these two men. Dimshitz was actually a pilot. He was going to actually pilot the plane. They sentenced them to death. And there was such a world outcry that eventually, after about a week and a half, the Soviets commuted the death sentence, and the fastest legal time the Soviets had ever done.
And they eventually wound up in the United States.
Yes, in the later in the 70s, they still served long prison terms. Yeah.
Now, Richard, you knew this man? He was your mentor. What was special about him? He was not Jewish. He was a senator of a state that probably had very few Jews. What was it about this issue that galvanized him? Was this purely an act of principle? Was there any self-interest in this? Was he truly a patron saint?
Scoop, all his life, was an opponent of totalitarianism in all its forms. He used to say that he found amazing, obscure ordinances when he was a prosecutor in Snohomish County, Washington State, that permitted him to run the brown shirts out of town, the fascists. And so it would be natural that he would align himself with people fighting for freedom. That for him was the most important thing. In its Jewish manifestation, it was deeply reinforced by his experience at the end of World War II when, as a congressman, he was present at the liberation of Buchenwald. And from that moment for the rest of his life, he did what he could, first to help the Jews of the world achieve a Jewish state. He was one of the early supporters. And then to do what he could to free them. But it was not just Jews that he was interested in. Scoop got involved with all kinds of freedom movements. There was a steady stream of people through his office. He was a truly great man.
Now, clearly the Jackson-Vanik Amendment was surely not in the spirit of what President Nixon and Secretary of State Kissinger wanted in their understanding of detente. They had a vision of quiet diplomacy in the way that the United States should handle, certainly, arms control, and in no way should the United States aggravate the Cold War. They should seek to de-escalate the Cold War. The Jackson-Vanik Amendment is nothing other than to inflame the Cold War. Can you just tell us a little about what the strategy was here? You were surely going against the American foreign policy of the Nixon administration.
Yes. Well, Scoop didn't accept the concept underlying détente. He did not believe that if the United States were to extend itself, engage in a variety of negotiations affecting not only military systems, but we tried to draw the Soviets into cooperative programs in space and energy and medicine and the like. He never accepted the view that this would somehow transform this fundamentally, quintessentially totalitarian state into something else. And he used to say, if you want to see why we should be concerned about what the Soviet Union in a position to do so would do to us, look at what they do to their own citizens. That was the rule he applied, not only to the Soviet Union, but generally. And so he couldn't imagine a fundamental change on the part of the Soviet Union.
John, let's take a look at another photo. Oh, Richard, now we see a different president and a vice president. Those are not cardboard cutouts.
They really
this
look
is,
like
in
it.
Fact, the Oval Office. We wouldn't do that to you. This is the 92nd Street Y, for God's sakes. In the center, of course, is Avital Sharansky, Natan's wife, and who we will mention in a moment. Yeah. And the gentleman to her left is Mendelevich, who yes, actually sir. Was in prison at the same time. He was released yeah. before you, but he shared not a cell, but close yeah. to you. Richard, can you just tell us, obviously President Reagan and his Secretary of State, George Shultz, had a foreign policy that was much more consistent, right, with the Jackson Amendment, and a much more of a deeper concern with human rights, as opposed to the realpolitik of détente.
Yes, that's quite right. Reagan, unlike all the presidents who preceded him, did not believe that the task of the American president was to find the best arrangement with the Soviet Union. He thought the best way was to eliminate the Soviet Union, principally by political means. And those speeches that some of you will recall about the evil empire and the ash heap of history and so forth, those speeches were intended to resonate with the people of the Soviet Union, who knew very well that their government was illegitimate. So it was political warfare. But looking at that picture, I hope you'll let me tell you a short story, because yes. it involves Avital, who's here tonight, and it involves George Shultz, Ronald Reagan's Secretary of State. This took place in Geneva at a summit meeting. I was there as the Defense Department representative, accompanying the State Department delegation headed by the Secretary of State, George Shultz. And Avital, who managed to go everywhere that there was a possibility of rallying support for Natan, had come to Geneva, and she wanted to hold a press conference, a briefing about Natan's situation, but she couldn't find a room in which to do it. So the American delegation at this summit was in the Hilton or the Intercontinental in Geneva, and the American delegation had a room. And as part of the delegation, I knew that. So I said to Avital, well, why don't you use our room? And she started to pass out circulars indicating there would be a press conference in this room at this time. And the next morning, the delegation had an early morning meeting, and someone from the State Department said, Mr. Secretary, you won't believe this, but Avital Sharansky has expropriated a State Department meeting room and plans to hold a press conference, and this will ruin the summit. And two or three other people in the meeting piped up with the same sentiment. And George Shultz listened to this, and then he said, his wife's name was Obi, he said, you know, I like to think that if I were in jail, Obi would find a room to speak for me.
Wow. That's a great anecdote, and that's not even in the book, Gal.
It's right.
There's one great anecdote. We'll just have to do a next edition, put the Richard Pearl anecdote. Hey, John, let's see and take a look at another photo. And Ellie, I want you to pay special attention to this one. Let's skip over that and go on to, yes. This is the Arkhipova Synagogue in Moscow. Yeah. And a very curious thing happened each year in Moscow, although the expression of religion was completely forbidden for Jews and others, certainly for Jews, and the Russian Jews, Soviet Jews, were, you know, spiritually and culturally annihilated. They had no connection to Judaism, and yet every year at Simchas Torah, tens of thousands of them would come outside this shul, and they would dance spontaneously. In 1965, Elie Wiesel went there to find out what was the situation with Soviet Jewry, to find out how bad it was. And so, Elie, why did you go? What were you looking for? What did you find?
When I went in 65, I went to see the Jews suffering, living in fear. And then I went to Kiev and Leningrad and so forth, and Moscow. But the real discovery was Simchat Torah. That was the first time that anyone came with a report to the world saying, hey, 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 the Russian Jews want to be Jewish, and they know how. They were dancing in the streets, singing. And I wrote about it. The most important thing I wrote at that time was not really the fear, the anguish, the oppression. It was the liberation. Thousands and thousands of youngsters came from all over town. And on Simchat Torah, outside the synagogue, they were dancing and singing in Yiddish, a few even in Hebrew. And that was my message, actually. They deserve our admiration and not only our solidarity. That's why I went.
Now, did they have a Torah?
Of course.
So, I mean, they had the Torahs. Did they know what they were doing? Was there a rabbi?
There were rabbis. First of all, the old rabbi, Levin, the chief rabbi of Moscow. I wrote actually a play about him. Poor man, frightened, demoralized, but he was a rabbi. But then there were many, many, many youngsters who studied Hebrew. We don't, I think, applaud enough what the state of Israel has done. They sent shlichim messengers, teachers actually, and they taught young Russian Jews Hebrew. I used to meet them in the cemeteries. It was safer. I taught them. I taught them Hebrew songs. I taught them Jewish history. I, as a teacher, was never more proud than when I did that. Here and there, in every place, I went to the cemetery, arranged, simply for me to meet them and teach them.
I can't help but note that in 1965 was only a mere 20 years after the liberation of Auschwitz. Clearly, both in the Jews of Silence and in your work on behalf of Soviet Jewry, you drew a parallel path. You connected the atrocity of the Holocaust and saw connections, and that, as Gall said a moment ago, the Soviet Jewry moment experience movement was redemptive in that way.
I don't compare. I compare nothing to what happened during the war. For me, what we so poorly call the Holocaust was a unique event. Never before and therefore, as we say, never again.
No, forgive me, I don't mean that parallel, but I mean the experience of the world's silence, the world's passivity, the world's inaction, how easy it is to forget. You have been a man of conscience and a man of memory, and obviously the idea of bearing witness to what was happening in the Soviet Union was clearly something that was on your mind and was in that book.
Oh, it is. It's not only that. Actually, here at the Y, when I came back from there, I came to the Y. It was my first encounter with the Y. And I gave a report about Soviet Jewry.
And this was before the book came out?
Before the book came out. And this is what I wrote. For me, it's the beginning. I said, their eyes. I must tell you about their eyes. I must begin with that. For their eyes precede all else. And everything is comprehended within them. The rest can wait. It will only confirm what you already know. But their eyes. Their eyes flame with a kind of irreducible truth, which burns and is not consumed. Shamed into silence before them, you can only bow your head and accept the judgment. Your only wish now is to see the world as they do. A grown man, a man of wisdom and experience, you are suddenly impotent and terribly impoverished. Those eyes remind you of your childhood, your orphan state, cause you to lose all faith in the power of language. Those eyes negate the value of words. They dispose of the need for speech. That was the beginning, and I read this here from this stage at that time. And since then, many, many years have passed. I will always remember the beginning.
And we're hearing it again. The book is, in many ways, a call to action for the American public and the world public to speak on behalf of Soviet Jewry. And many Americans rose to that challenge. Let's, John, let's take another look at some photos. So this is Yaakov Birnbaum, right, Gal, who very much deserves an applause. He was the founder of the SSSJ, the Students to Save Soviet Jewry, which was a group of liberal and secular and religious students. Young people, very much called to social activism of its time. The very same people who were seeing the SDS in Berkeley and anti-war movement. There was the SSSJ was a peaceful, nonviolent movement, growing and strong and young. Let's take a look at another photo. Ah, yes. This, of course, is the hippie Rabbi Shlomo Carbach. Still with the shul on West 79th Street, who many people may not remember, Am Yisrael Chai, was written as an anthem for Soviet Jewry. And the SSSJ, these gatherings, these solidarity marches were highly, very well attended. Yaakov Birnbaum had organized them with the students. And, you know, it's hard to imagine this time. This is, you know, this is pre-Woodstock, of course. But it does have... It does have, let's put it this way, think, you know, Occupy Wall Street with lots more people and less marijuana. And you have what this looks like, and this is Carlbach. Let's take a look at another photo. And this is Meir Kahane, who I think had just posted bail and was coming out after being convicted of another crime of disorderly conduct. And he's surrounded by his followers from the Jewish Defense League, which, for those of you who don't remember, was sort of the Jewish answer to black power, and Jewish pride and Jewish power. And they were decidedly violent and not interested in peaceful demonstrations. Let's take a look at another one. Ah, yes, and that's the example of it. These are Jewish boys, ladies and gentlemen. They do not have yeshiva books. They have pipe bombs and baseball bats, and they look serious. Let's talk about this, all of this, for a moment. These are different groups. One idea that comes out of the Beckerman book is that the Jewish mainstream establishment believed in Jewish respectability, in being quiet diplomacy. And these groups, Jewish Defense League, surely to a much more larger extent, believed in noise. Richard, in Gal's book, there's a great anecdote of you tossing an American Jewish committee official out of your office. Do you remember this story? You just tossed him out.
Well, there was, in fact, an American Jewish bureaucrat tossed out of the office, but I didn't do the tossing. The tossing was done by a diminutive 5-foot woman, wonderful woman named Dorothy Fosdick, who was the daughter of Harry Emerson Fosdick, who'd been a pacifist in World War II. And this particular official was complaining about our efforts on behalf of the Soviet Jews because we were a little loud and aggressive. And she said, and he was particularly critical of me, and Dorothy was like a surrogate mother. She said, "You won't talk to Richard that way," and she ushered him out of the office. He was stunned. He was stunned. He was an iconic figure in the Jewish community at the time, but that didn't matter to Dorothy. But there was tension between, certainly between the activists who were out in the streets demonstrating and the establishment Jewish leaders.
So, you know, Gal speaks about, writes about this extensively. It's essentially Nahum Goldman in the World Jewish Congress represented the mainstream Jewish establishment, and Lou Rosenblum was part of the grassroots. Another photo that we don't have certainly deserves recognition. Lou yeah. Rosenblum, who organized the grassroots around the country and very much opposed to the efforts of mainstream Jewish establishment. Let's talk about Kahane. A polarizing figure. I mean, Ellie, this is a rabbi, for God's sakes. A rabbi who, you know, teaches karate, and a rabbi who teaches pipe bombs. You're a Nobel Peace Prize winner. And yet, this was one of the strategies that was used. And let me just say, not an effective strategy. I mean, it just so happens that when the JDL was at its most violent, when they were harassing Soviet diplomats who were walking around the street, when they upstaged the Bolshoi Ballet by, I think, throwing mice onto the stage. You gotta love that one. The Soviet Union actually gave out more exit visas in response to the violence. I mean, is this troubling for you, that statistics? I mean, how did you feel about Kahane? And I'm going to ask all of you, because he was so polarizing, and yet everyone has an opinion.
Saying we belong to a tradition that prohibits me from saying anything bad about someone who is dead.
That is a very diplomatic, noblest worthy reply. Nathan, he eventually was in Israel.
No. Well, I am not a diplomat, so I can tell straight that in the very beginning of the struggle, even Kahane started fighting like student struggle for Soviet Jewry before we started, and we loved him. We really loved the fact there is somebody who is bringing our problem to the center of the attention. In fact, for us, it was like a continuation of the book of Eli, The Jews of Silence, that American Jews should not be Jews of Silence, and here is their voice. And the fact that there was even song which made in the underground, Jewish underground, something like, "We had enough the best violence in the world. Now we need hooligans." That was the motive. Let's start fighting. I have to say that in the 72, I don't remember exactly, but at some moment we felt, some of us, and I was among them, that now it becomes a big, that Kahane becomes now more problem than this. In the beginning it was one of the most important allies. But then when there was shooting in the Soviet embassy, when there was burning of this agency, the office which was organizing traveling, and the secretary, I don't remember her name.
A woman died.
Except from the moral issue, but all our power in the Soviet Union was the power of Yod, that against this tyranny, we put the word, we are not violent, but our word has a lot of power. The fact that our allies are using violence, which can bring to the death of the people, was under, lining our course. And I remember then I was among those few who wrote our first letter calling to Rav Kahana to stop this type of activity. And we were condemned among our own because they said, look, we don't have so many allies and you should not do it publicly. But we really felt that it becomes a problem. So when I came to Israel many years after this, the Rav Kahana tried to build bridges, saying that our struggle is his struggle. I had publicly to say that no, it's not our struggle. And many of supporters of Kahana were very upset, because really I have to say that he was one of the first and he was very, very important. But all his activity from the late 70s and after, I think, was much more damaging than helping.
Gal, your book sets up what I would call a symphony of disparate groups, all working to do the same thing with different methods. And of course, this is one of those situations where the old adage, you know, two Jews, three opinions, doesn't really work, because this was a situation where all Jews were united when it came to Soviet Jewry. They may have had different methods.
Right. Strategies.
Strategies. Yeah, yeah. Just in your mind, any one more important than the other, or was it really a choreography that worked in concert and that it all worked together? And the reason I'm asking, because I want to ask the other gentleman on the stage, if nothing had happened, if there was no SSSJ, there was no JDL, there was no Richard Pearl and Scoop Jackson, if nothing had happened, would the Soviet Union had collapsed on its own? And the Soviet Jews would have eventually been free. I mean, if you read the book, it seems unthinkable. It seems like it was only because of these efforts of protest. If there had been no Jews of silence, if there had been none of this, would have communism have just come to an end?
Those are a lot of questions. I mean, to separate them out for a minute, I refuse to say that one person did more than anybody else.
Well, we know that these three are the most important.
Exactly. Mostly because every single event that I've given around the book, there is inevitably somebody who raises their hand at the end during the question and answer and says, I looked in your index and I didn't see my Uncle Murray, who started the Long Island Committee of Soviet Jewry, and he was the one who got them out. Always. No, it was an orchestra, and Kahana played his part as well. He got Soviet Jewry on the front page more than anybody else had up to that point. He created a situation that I think, or a strategy that might have even, just been a precedent to the Jackson-Banik Amendment, which is to make this a problem between the superpowers, a problem that needed to be resolved. And then maybe that leads to answer the second part of your question of whether this movement had a part in actually getting Jews out, and not a small part, I think, in kind of chipping away at the Soviet Union. Yes, because this issue was about immigration. It was about letting people out. It was about people's free choice to live wherever they want, to not choose not to live in a totalitarian regime. And for 25, 30 years, these activists just pounded and pounded and pounded and pounded until the Soviets understood that this was the concession that they had to make. I mean, by the period of Reagan, every meeting that he has with Gorbachev, he starts off with a list of names of people that he demands or, you know, need to get out before we get to talking about arms control or any of the other things that the Soviets wanted. So by that point, it was nearly a conditioning project. The Soviets had been conditioned to understand, because of the Jackson-Banik Amendment and all the activism, that this was the issue. This was the issue that mattered to Americans.
Richard, do you agree with this? The Cold War comes to an end in part because of the efforts on behalf of Soviet Jewry?
I think the movement focused on the complete absence of human rights in the Soviet Union. It's hard to imagine, but the Soviet Union had its apologists. It had intellectuals who argued that they had solved the problem of universal health care and they had brought about a more decent distribution of income, and they had an economy that was growing faster than ours. Now we forget that there was real controversy about the Soviet Union, and especially in the period of when the Nixon administration was promoting the idea of a detente. And there was a real argument that the Soviet Union was evolving and could be encouraged to evolve even further. But before you get to the end, I think it's important to note that tens of thousands of people got out before the Soviet Union collapsed. And so it isn't as if we had to await the collapse. And just a footnote to some of this history, in Reagan's first meeting with Gorbachev, he of course raised the Sharansky question, and Gorbachev said, Sharansky's a spy. And he was advised to look into it further. And never really, I mean, there was a trade, a ridiculous trade, because you had an innocent man on one side and an agent on the other. So even as late as early Gorbachev, there was real anger about the problems inflicted on the Soviet image in the world by these obstreperous Jews.
Natan, we saw a photo earlier of your wife, Avital. You were a prisoner of conscience, of course, but the story of her imprisonment is also a love story. You marry Avital the day before she emigrates to Israel. You don't see her again for well over a decade. If you don't mind, I'd like to read what you said in Israel, just a piece of what you said. You said about Avital, you said, you know, I dreamed many times while in prison of arriving in our land, and there my Avital would be waiting for me. But in my dreams, whenever we began to embrace, I would wake up in my cell. And you were finally rejoined, but throughout that entire time, and Richard reminds us, did you know that you had married a woman who would be such a ferocious global ambassador all over the world, an advocate not only to release her husband, but on behalf of Soviet Jewry? Did you get a sense of this when you knew her?
Well, when we were separated, it was a very shy, very quiet, very naive girl who hardly spoke a word except for Russian. And when I met her 12 years after this, she was one of the most experienced leaders of political struggles who opened the doors of every leader in the world. So no, I didn't know. So I did not know that it will happen, that won't, but I did feel how strong she is, how devoted she is. I did know already before I went to prison how Israel, meeting with Israel, empowered her, inspired her, made her feel very strongly that we are living in the times of miracles, and that no doubt another miracle will happen, will come. So with all her faith and inner strength, I was sure that everything what KGB is telling me is lies, and of course the world will never forget my case simply because Avital will not permit the world to forget my case.
Eta, let me tell you who Avital is. No one has ever given me so much trouble as she has. ask Marion, my wife. What do you mean? She would wake me up at 4 in the morning. And she knew more about my calendar than I did. You are going to see next week, she said, we don't. Speak about Nathan. You are going to Paris, you'll see the president. Speak about that. I didn't even know I was going there. But she knew. So Avital really is someone very, very special.
We're sitting with Elie Wiesel, and we can't help but be reminded that he's always reminding us that, you know, Auschwitz is always with him. This is not something one walks away from. it shaped his worldview, it shaped his life, his career, his message. Can we say the same thing, Natan, about your imprisonment in the Soviet Union? Can we at least say that it has shaped your worldview and there's a part of you that's still there in some painful way?
Look, I was lucky that struggle for me didn't start from imprisonment. There were a few years during which, first of all, you discover your identity. Second, you discover how powerful it's Jewish solidarity. You reconnect yourself to all this. So my life in prison was like a continuation of this struggle, which continues every day. And of course, it was a very tough life, of course, and I wouldn't compare it with Auschwitz, of course, but they were using many methods to try to destroy your spirit. And from this point, yes, you learn how to feel that every day that you lived true to your principles is another day of victory. You have to live with constant feeling that victory is not something in the end of your life, that this feeling of the struggle, which happens every moment, and victory or failure every moment, that's something what you learn in prison, to this moral clarity, which is very difficult to reach and to understand when you're not in prison.
Let me ask you gentlemen this one question. I think at least all of you might have some response to this, but Gal and certainly Richard might. I was born in New York, but I was raised in Miami during the Cold War. 90 miles south of Key West is Cuba, a satellite of the Soviet Union. Castro, by the way, who's still essentially in power all these years, the Soviet Union has collapsed. Cuba is still with us, still a communist country. It's like the Energizer Bunny country. Castro, in 1960, says to the Jews, go to Miami Beach, become rich. And they did. We called them Jubins. And they came and they reinvented their lives. They built an entire world for themselves. Castro said, you don't want to be here, I don't want you here. Why didn't the Soviet Union do this? Why didn't they just say, we're buying ourselves a headache? Richard, give us the advice inside the Oval Office. You were an advisor to two American presidents. Explain the mind of the Soviet Union in this issue.
Well, I think a succession of Soviet leaders believed that if they acceded to the demands that the Jews of Russia should be permitted to leave, that the whole system would unravel, that it would fall apart. First of all, they knew that behind the Jews, there were an awful lot of other people who wanted to leave, who were not so fortunate as to have co-religionists staying up late at night organizing demonstrations. And it was an extraordinary thing in communities all over the United States, housewives, lawyers, physicians, people in every walk of life extended themselves to do what they could in support of the Jews of the Soviet Union. People wore names on their wrists. And there were names like Sharansky. And if you ask me what was the single most important thing, it was the effort the Soviet Jews made to free themselves. You know, outside in the diaspora you could help, but they did it. And they inspired those who worked hard to help them outside. The Soviets understood that once they opened the gates, somebody would have to stay to turn off the lights.
Because of your question to Richard, it reminded me my first conversation with President Reagan, exactly on this topic. I came, I thanked him for all his efforts. I thanked him for his great speech on evil empire, which reached us in prison, and which showed us that finally there is a leader who understands Soviet Union. But then he told me an anecdote. President Reagan says to Bush and to Schultz, who are there, and said, look, I heard such an anecdote. And he tells me old anecdote that Brezhnev and Kosygin, who were number one and number two in the Soviet Union, are sitting together and discussing, maybe we will open the gates of the Soviet Union to all these Jews, while we are suffering for all this pressure, let them go. And then Kosygin says to Brezhnev, no, if you'll do it, only two of us will remain, everybody will leave. And then Brezhnev says, no, speak for yourself. So I have to say that Reagan says the story, and he laughs, and Bush laughs, and Schultz laughs, and everybody laughs. And I'm a little bit saddened. Why? Because that's an old joke which I heard 25 years ago. So you came to White House, and that's what you hear. But then Reagan says to his colleagues, you understand, that's the joke which Soviet people say themselves. That's what they think. And then I understand, my God, here is a politician who understands that he doesn't have to listen to what Soviets say, that Soviet people don't want to leave and so on. He asks CIA to tell him what jokes Soviet people say. And from this, he understands a much better situation.
I also thought one of you would say there would be an extraordinary brain drain.
Yeah, that was an issue.
Right, that is an issue. Yeah. I mean, 100,000 of the Jews that Soviet Jews went to Israel, 100,000 engineers, 23,000 doctors.
Violinists.
And violinists. Elie Wiesel.
And chess players. And chess players.
And chess players. What would the Soviet Union be without the Jews? Which just begs this one question. There's still 1.5 million Jews in Russia. What do we know about them? Do they come to dance at the synagogue on Simchas Torah? Do they learn Hebrew? What happened to them now that they are free?
First of all, I'm glad to hear this figure, 1.5 million, because our official figure is 850,000. Well, some Chabad rabbis say that there are 3 million. I always hope that Chabad is closer to God, so they know better. Maybe there are 3 million. But as an official Jewish bureaucrat, I have to rely on official statistics. It's approximately 850,000. Yes, this time they can live as the Jews, or they can leave. We can help them to build Jewish communities. They are coming on Jewish holidays. They are dancing. There is full Jewish life. What is good, I can say, in the last year at least, statistics shows that young Jews from St. Petersburg and Moscow start living for Israel in much bigger figures.
All right. Now, I'm about to read something, and I'm saying if you have a heart condition, I'm going to ask you to leave now. Henry Kissinger, a year ago, roughly a year ago, when the Nixon Library had released another series of tapes from the Oval Office. It's interesting, in Gal Beckerman's book, the scene itself is described. You just didn't know what happened after. Golda Meir comes to visit Nixon and Kissinger in the Oval Office.
Right.
She makes a number of requests, one of them.
It's March of 1973, and the Jackson-Vanik Amendment is really picking up steam, and Nixon and Kissinger are actually trying to get Golda to pull the American Jewish community off of this issue. And Golda throws up her hands and says, I can't tell American Jews what to do. If they care about this, they care about this.
So Golda Meir leaves the office.
Which is a convenient thing for her to say also, because she...
can I just add one, because it was such a charming moment. Golda Meir listened to the President of the United States explaining why it was in Israel's interest that American Jews scale back their effort on behalf of Soviet Jews. And he laid it all out. He had an argument. And she listened to him, and when he was finished, she said, Mr. President, you want me to tell this to the Jews?
So Golda Meir leaves the Oval Office, the tape recorder is on, and this is the conversation between his Secretary of State, Kissinger, and the President of the United States, Nixon. It begins with Kissinger. I'm not doing it with a German accent, I'm just doing it. The emigration of Jews from the Soviet Union is not an objective of American foreign policy, Kissinger said. And if they put Jews into gas chambers in the Soviet Union, it is not an American concern. Maybe a humanitarian concern.
Maybe.
Yeah, maybe.
I like the maybe, yeah.
Maybe, maybe. And of course, the President of the United States says, I know, Nixon responded. We can't blow up the world because of it. Ellie, a reaction when you heard this a year ago? He didn't have to make a reference to concentration camps. He could have simply said, it's not in our, in the world of realpolitik, it's not in our best interest. He doesn't have to add the concentration camps, the death camps. By the way, Kissinger's still alive. You know, I am a law professor. I want to remind the noblest that rule isn't going to work this time.
All I can tell you is we had very good relations with him for many, 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 many years. But I haven't spoken to him since. Since I've read it, I couldn't speak to him.
Richard, did this tape surprise you?
Yes, it did. It did. I can well imagine Kissinger arguing the realpolitik, that we don't have the leverage, this is an inappropriate use of our influence. But the way he chose to express it was truly shocking.
A Jewish refugee, hey. A Jewish refugee, sort of refugees. No sense of Jewish history. I don't understand it. And he's an intelligent person, learned, cultured. I don't know. What happened? What happened to him? I don't know.
Well, you know, this does play into all the premises of the court Jew. The person so close to power, he says exactly what the king or the president wants to hear. He knows how to play the game. He knows how he got into the White House. And he knows what to say. He says the very thing that maybe Nixon couldn't say, even on tape, even in the Oval Office. Gall, you know, the book speaks about how often Nixon and Kissinger try to co-opt the Jewish community, to sweet talk them, to tell them that they were partners in the process of detente, to tell them that all of these efforts, whether they Wiesel or SSSJ or the JDL, were undermining foreign relations, making the world less safe. Is this an old story? I mean, Ellie, I know that you know during the Holocaust, there was, you know, Rabbi Stephen Wise, there were people who had the ear of Roosevelt, but didn't say what they needed to say. Do you think this is a familiar pattern? The Jewish establishment essentially capitulates to staying influential. And in order to stay influential, you don't rock the boat.
I don't like to generalize, to say the Jewish establishment. It is composed of so many, a variety of people, all kinds of backgrounds. I don't know, but somehow, nonetheless, the names that you mentioned, a few others, were not what they should have been, spokesmen for our people. I'll give you an example, you know. When I spoke to Reagan, when I told him that I belong to a tradition that commands me to speak truth to power. That was the Bitburg. You know why I did it? I didn't know that. Where did I take the courage to speak like that to a president in the White House who was going to honor me? I remembered coming back. I was there in the plane together with Marion. All of a sudden I remembered that actually I wanted to show the leaders of our people that you can speak truth to power as Jews in the White House. That is why.
John, let's take a look at our last photo. There we go. So this is 1987. It's in color. This is the March on Washington. 250,000 in support of Soviet Jewry. Gall's book points out that the early 1980s was a disaster for exit visas, only trickling out at that point, right, Gall?
Yeah.
And here in 1987, Eli, you spoke here.
Sure. Look, I'll tell you. I published an op-ed piece a few months earlier in the New York Times saying, look, why not do what others have done in March in Washington? And that's slowly then. Nathan came and it worked. We spoke earlier about the reaction of the Jews in America. During what we call the Churban, the destruction, they were not up to the standard during those times. They were afraid. And that was true about the Jewish movement as well. It was very, very hard to move the Jewish community. I remember together with Abraham Joshua Heschel, the two of us were going from place to place. We organized demonstrations. You know who came to our demonstrations? Children, students, but not the parents. The parents would bring them to a demonstration and leave. Nobody wanted to hear about it. I remember the first time I spoke about it to a huge General Assembly of the Jewish Federations in Kansas City. I think it was in 69 or 70. And that's when I gave them a piece of my mind. What are you doing? You are here? The entire evening, the word Soviet Jewry wasn't even mentioned. I was the last speaker. The entire evening, was Motzei Shabbat, and there were, I think, usually they have 3,000-4,000 people from all over America. It wasn't even mentioned. And because I gave them a very strong criticism, that on the spot they organized the first delegations to Russia. The first. They were embarrassed. Now remember, you mentioned this book. At the end of my book, what do I say? I believe with all my soul that despite the suffering, despite the hardship and the fear, the Jews of Russia will withstand the pressure and emerge victorious. But whether or not we shall ever be worthy of their trust, whether or not we shall overcome the pressures we have ourselves created, I cannot say I returned from the Soviet Union disheartened and depressed. But what torments me most is not the Jews of silence I met in Russia, but the silence of the Jews I live among today.
Richard, when you look at this photo, you were working at that point for the Reagan administration. Does this make you think in 1977, Natan, you're already out, you're in Israel? Is this the end? Did we think, when you look at this?
This was Natan's demonstration.
Right.
And mine.
And yours. Absolutely.
But did we think...
And it was organized over the opposition of people who should have been contributing to it. And it was extraordinary how successful it was, given the absence of support that should have been forthcoming. Although, if I recall correctly, Natan, once people failed to dissuade the Elie Wiesels and the Natan Sharansky's from attempting the demonstration, then they got on board when it was, well, the people were leading, they were going to follow. So this demonstration would not have happened except for a couple of people, and they're right here, and it really was the end.
And everyone there thought this was the end, or is it only people in the White House who thought this might be it?
Well, of course, the White House was not at all unhappy about this, and which made it different from some other demonstrations where administrations were very unhappy.
Which is why it was actually a very, it had to be organized very carefully, because it wasn't a demonstration against Reagan's policy necessarily, and not even necessarily against Gorbachev, because he was, within the battles that were happening in the Kremlin at that moment, he was kind of, you know, more of a reformer than the communist hardliners. So the demonstration actually took place a day before his visit. And I think Natan, actually, you asked for 400,000 people, so it must have been a letdown for you.
Well, I think that this demonstration is really symbolizes in many ways how this struggle was developing, that you need activists who irritate establishment, but then you need establishment who will be mobilized and who will put all these efforts. It's true that Elie Wiesel spoke about the need of big demonstration. That when I came with my first visit to New York, and I saw that this figure, that we are speaking about hundreds of thousands of Jews who still want to come, was not really caught. People were speaking about 2,000 refuseniks, 25 prisoners of Zion. So I said, when Gorbachev will come first time, let's 400,000 American Jews go to Washington. I said 400,000 simply in order it will be understood that we are speaking about big figures. I said, for every Jew in Soviet Union who wants to come, let's 400,000 come. And then the reaction of establishment was, in many ways, fear. They said, you're speaking about these big figures. There is no way to bring hundreds of thousands of American Jews to Washington in winter. The special said, maximum 20,000. You cannot bring more. But the second big fear was that everybody loves Gorbachev. Finally, there is detente, real detente. And we will irritate American government, American administration, President Reagan, against the Jews. That for Jews, their cause is much more important than the chance for peace. And then I decided, I couldn't say anything about it. After all, I'm not an American Jew. So I said, I decided I'll have to ask Reagan whether he will be upset or not upset. And there was a pretext that Vitaly and I never met Reagan together. We always went separately, so we want to say him thank you. And we met President Reagan, and he was already very old, and he was already not very old. It was the end of his term, and he was confusing dates. And but he looked at us as a very proud grandfather, that he sees the results of his work. And he says that, you know, I just... Dear Mr. and Mrs. Shevardnadze, he says to us, I just spoke with Foreign Minister Sharansky, and I told him that you should better let Soviet Jews go because we will not make compromise with this. And he's, and people are in the room, we are really very confused that he made this mistake. My God, if I wasn't Russian, I also would confuse Sharansky, Shevardnadze. So I pretend I didn't notice, and I go straight and say, Mr. President, soon you will see not only foreign minister, but president himself, or whatever, secretary of Communist Party himself. So I want you to know that Jewish community and Jewish activists want to organize big demonstration, and I hope you understand that it's not against, and I'm trying to use the words because I don't want to ask permission, because what if he'll say no, I'm going to have it anyway. But also, on the other hand, I do want to say to the others that it's okay. So I start choosing words, and he suddenly says, what? You think that I'm interested, that somebody can think that I'm interested in being friends with Soviets while they're keeping their people in prison? You do everything what you have, don't have any hesitations, and I'll do my part. So then I went out and said, look, Reagan is for our demonstration. What is our concern?
All right, let's take a few questions from our audience here and our for audience watching from satellite in other cities around the United States and Canada, and then we'll say goodnight. This is for Natan. Do you relate to Gilad Shalit? And how are prisoners of war in today's world treated differently? And what are the diplomatic implications for Israel in the Middle East in the treatment of prisoners?
Well, look, first of all, we're very happy that Gilad was released. That's without question. As to the more difficult question, what about exchanging Gilad Shalit for 1,000? Terrorists. It's much more complicated. I can only say that when I was in the government and the previous government, and such a deal of this type was discussed, I voted against, and Ariel Sharon called me and said that as the one who was in prison, you have to vote for this. And I said, as the one who was in prison, I understand why I have to vote against. So that's a big debate in Israeli society. Now, as to treatment of our prisons, I have to say that Gilad Shalit is not a typical example because he was captured in order to be exchanged. So they treated him well. Our prisoners of war, of Israel prisoners of war, well, even in his case, it was a violation of all international laws of keeping prisoners because he was in full isolation, Red Cross, nobody could see him. But in normal case, our prisoners are tortured, are mutilated, are raped, all types of violations. And from this point, it's always a reminder what a different world is Israel and our neighbors. And the fact that the free world is ignoring this principal difference is a big disgrace.
All right, this is a question. This is a question from Orlando, Florida, which is not a big place for Cuban Jews, but it is Florida. Do you think that the Six-Day War began the resurgence of pride for Jewish Americans and therefore laid the groundwork for support of the struggle for Silver Jewry? I mean, we know, Gal, this comes up in your book frequently, that the Six-Day yes. War played a role, and maybe we'll get you and maybe Richard to speak to that.
Yeah, it played an extraordinary role. I mean, it was, we talked earlier about kind of redemptive moments. This was, you know, here was not that many years from the Holocaust, and here was this extraordinary victory that made Jews feel connected to Israel, many of them for the first time. But, you know, it also was maybe even a bigger impact on Soviet Jews. And in the Soviet Union, remember, there was something a little subversive about the feeling of pride that Soviet Jews felt, because who were the allies of Israel's enemies in the Six-Day War? They were the Soviets. So that extraordinary moment that we remember of the Israeli Air Force destroying the Egyptian Air Force in a morning, those are Soviet planes. So if you're a Soviet Jew living in the Soviet Union, it forces you immediately to confront the paradox of your existence as somebody who's Jewish and is kind of connected to this Jewish state, but is also a Soviet citizen. So for many people, it prompted them to really have a crisis of conscience. Proportionately, you know, the people who kind of would become activists, a lot of them, this was a big, big moment for them.
Richard? Did the Six-Day War provide a complete change in attitude of American Jews? Did it ennoble them? Did it enable them? Did it make them feel stronger and less apologetic?
I think the word pride was appropriately used. And you had, in those days, the narrative which has now changed in a very unfortunate way was little Israel surrounded by much larger powers determined to destroy little Israel. Now it's high-tech Israel, still surrounded by countries that want to destroy it. But I think the big impact was in the Soviet Union, and I've discussed this with Natan, so maybe you should say something about that.
Well, that was the turning point, and I have to say not simply pride. It's much more complicated. I and many in my generation, were absolutely assimilated Soviet Jews. We knew nothing about our Jewishness except of anti-Semitism. So to be Jew is like to have a disease with which you have to survive somehow. There was nothing good in it. And then there was Six-Day War and big humiliation for Soviet Union. And so a big anti-Israeli campaign, which also turns into anti-Semitic campaign. And jokes about, anti-Semitic jokes about Jews suddenly are not about Jews who are cowards and parasites, but about Jews who are hooligans who are beating their neighbors. And so you understand suddenly that whether you want or not, but for all these people who hate you or who love you, you are connected to Israel. And it was after Six-Day War when suddenly it became so clear that they look at us through the eyes of what's happening in Israel. And then you want to understand what it means, and then you start in the underground to learn, and then you discover your history, discover Jewish people, and discover Israel. And that's how you have strength to fight. So it has huge impact. Without Six-Day War, I don't know if it would start.
It happened, it changed everybody. Jews changed. Assimilated Jews stopped being assimilated. Mm-hmm. Even those who were anti-something in Judaism, somehow There was such an awakening. I remember it because I wrote about it afterwards, a book called A Beggar in Jerusalem. My God. It had metaphysical dimensions. It wasn't simply a military operation. Something metaphysical, especially because of Jerusalem. I remember I went to Israel the moment it began. And you know, I knew already Marion, and it wasn't easy, but she accepted I should leave. My God. I went to the old city right away. I ran to the wall. It was a week after the wall was liberated. From morning to evening, I stood there with my whip, with my lips simply whispering prayers. And I wrote about it. It was, for me, it was one of the greatest events in my life. God knows I had enough great, not so great events as well in my life. But this was extraordinary. You had a feeling that from all the corners of exile, from the deepest corners of exile, Jews all of a sudden rose and came there, and to be together. So I can tell you, all the people in the world, Jews, change.
It's so wonderful that we're ending here with invoking the word and the name and the place metaphysically and actually of Jerusalem. We all know the end of the Pesach Seder, the Haggadah says, next year in Jerusalem. And at the end of Yom Kippur, we say, next year in Jerusalem. And through the efforts of these three courageous and heroic men and so many countless others, and the gratitude of this young writer who gave us an opportunity to bring us all together, next year it's possible, the option to always say for Russian Jews, next year in Jerusalem has been made possible. Thank you.
Thank you. So moving what you read, I want to be forgetful.